Please welcome Vice President Joseph R. Biden.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much for your presence and for your warm reception. It is for me an honor to be asked to introduce the Vice President of the United States. It's a special privilege for me to introduce my good and dear friend, Joe Biden. He has devoted his life to serving his country as a senator and as the vice president. Throughout his time in the Senate, and for me, especially during the years that I served as the Senate Majority Leader, I worked closely with him on a daily basis on many critical issues. On some, we prevailed. On some, we did not. But through all of the triumphs and all of the tragedies, I came to know well a man whose commitment to our country and to our founding principles is total, and whose energy and skill in upholding those principles, advancing our nation's interests, is unsurpassed. Many analysts of the Senate and historians of its past have divided senators into two categories: show horses and work horses. And you will not be surprised that there are more show than work. But I can say to you that this was, during his long and outstanding career, one of the true workhorses in the Senate. And I believe that future historians of that institution will identify him as one of the two or three great legislators of our era. Men who had not just the courage and vision to write important legislation, but the tenacity and the skill to see it into law. An event that rarely occurs now in the modern Senate. I think probably Joe Biden and Ted Kennedy will be the two most highly rated by future historians. I saw Joe Biden take complex legislation with many, many moving parts, and over the course of not months but years, work diligently to persuade senators on both sides of the aisle to act in the nation's interest. And I think it's significant in the light of what we see now in our Congress that as many Republicans as Democrats regarded Joe as a friend, a man who could be trusted, a man whose word was his bond, and who had only the national interest at heart. As Vice President, we've all seen him be of great support to our President and to our country. There's a limited time because the Vice President has to go on to another event, and I know you came this evening's event to hear him, not me.
Keep going, but George. This is good.
But I just say, after one particularly very, very difficult legislative battle in the Senate, an important one over the Clean Air Act, it passed by one vote and Joe Biden cast the deciding vote. And when it was over, I walked over to him and I said to him, "Joe, you've got guts." And believe me, Joe Biden does have guts, along with brains, courage, integrity, and eloquence. It's my great honor to present to you my friend, the Vice President of the United States, Joe Biden.
I've got to leave now. I don't want to turn this into a mutual admiration society. That old joke, if my father were here, he'd believe it. If my mother were here, she'd wonder whether we were talking about my younger brother. But folks, I was really proud to serve in the United States, and I'm proud to be vice president, but I consider myself a Senate man more than anything else. I served there for a long, long time. Matter of fact, George had left before I left, and when I was elected my seventh term, it was the year I got elected vice president at the same time because of a quirk in the law in Delaware. I had to run for both offices. And when it was time for me to — I got sworn in, and there were 13 days of legislation before I left to be sworn in on January 20th with the president to be vice president of the United States. And the Senate historian came in, and they do what they call a history minute in the caucuses, the Republican caucus and the Democratic caucus, and once a week. And they come in and say, on this day in 1890, such and such happened or whatever. And so the Senate historian walked in on my last day to the luncheon and said, the Vice President-elect's colleagues should know, and he was trying to make me feel good, that there are only 13 people in American history who've ever served as long as Joe Biden. And I thought, oh, my God, how could that be? But the point is, I've known an awful lot of senators, and you all know George Mitchell. The two people who I served with for 36 years, the two men with more integrity in their little finger than most people have in their whole body, were a senator named Mike Mansfield from Montana. I used to refer to him as Iron Mike, who served when I got there in 72, and George Mitchell. And George made my job as chairman of foreign relations and judiciary committees for a total of, I had those positions for 25 or so years, made it work for me. So I want to thank George. And as many of you have probably heard, there was another shooting today at a community college in rural Oregon. I don't have the details yet, but unfortunately, this has been happening far too often. The estimates are there's somewhere between 10 and 13 dead students, and somewhere between 15 and 25 additionally seriously wounded. So I want to say at the outset here, as you all know, there's nothing — well, there may be, but there's few things worse than getting that phone call saying your child is gone. Your child is gone. Or your brother, your sister, your husband, your wife. And folks, part of the dysfunction of our political system today is that there is an overwhelming consensus in America on both — on two things that are equally defensible: the Second Amendment and sane gun legislation relating to background checks and the ability to — the Second Amendment doesn't say you can own a bazooka. It doesn't say you can own an F-15 with Hellfire missiles. There's the ability of the government to limit the type of weapon that is available. And although we don't have enough information now, we don't have enough information now for me to comment on the specifics. My guess is, I'm prepared to bet you, that it was a semi-automatic or an automatic weapon. I don't know that yet, but that would be my guess. For so many people to be shot in such a short amount of time. We're basically the only civilized country in the world where we have these massive murders in our country. And 87% of the American people agreed with the proposal I put together for the president on background checks and gun safety. Even over 60% of NRA families, National Rifle Association families, support it. So, folks, I cite that as part of the dysfunction because we're able to have decided minorities prevent consensus from occurring, which doesn't directly lead into what we're talking about today, but because my wife, I think, I'm not positive, this is the only first or second lady that is a full-time job for the last 7 years. She teaches 15 credits. She has her two masters and a doctorate. She teaches at a community college. And it brings home every time something happens in the school. Just how the safest place on earth should be, our schools and our colleges. But that's for another day. So my thoughts and prayers, I'm sure along with yours, with the families who've lost folks today. You've been discussing, and you've had a long day, and I understand you're all day tomorrow, you've been discussing a lot of consequential issues facing the world, from public health issues to fights against extremism. And all these things are going to take time to impact on. But I want to make the point, the founders of this fora, I think, believe, and I'm confident that if we focus all the stakeholders on these problems, there's not a problem we cannot solve. So I say to Nick and Matt, and understand Mom's here today, Mom's here today, Mom would, as they say, Mom, as they say in Southern Delaware, they speak with accent, you done good with that boy. You done good with that boy. Thank you for what you've done. Thank you. And I understand this is the fifth anniversary of this forum, and it's an honor to be here, addressing the important issues that facing the country and the world requires immense determination, a combinations of everyone who has a stake in the shared success of the outcome of the issues you've raised. And that's why I admire Concordia so much. 5 years ago, you brought together the brightest minds of all sectors of society, government, policymakers, business executives, nonprofits, academics, to deal with the vexing problems the world faces. And now you're launching a Concordia campaign to focus on the scourge of human trafficking, which affects every country and every society. And defeating it is going to take a hell of a lot of coordination and work because there's so many moving parts. And it's vital to our future because societies where human trafficking is the norm, people live in fear literally of letting their child walk out the front door of their home. Schools are viewed as targets and not havens. Children don't have the opportunity to live their full potential. Investors avoid rather than invest in the communities that are deteriorating because of it, that need help badly. And it's a stain. It's a stain on the reputation of so many countries. Whether we're talking about poverty or human trafficking or generating an environment that can attract business to generate jobs and opportunity, all these things are impacted, in my view, if you'll forgive me, by three overriding concerns that overarchingly affect the possibility of making progress in all the things you've talked about. The first is endemic corruption, state-sponsored corruption. Some of you have heard me say in speeches I've made on behalf of the administration that with regard to Russia in particular, but China to some degree, there are two new foreign policy weapons in the arsenal of any of those two countries. One is the use of oligarchs and endemic corruption to undermine the stability of governments. And the second is use of energy as a weapon. But corruption is a cancer that eats away at the body politic that is designed to unite societies in order to be able to function. Corruption siphons away resources. It stunts economic growth. It prevents the establishing of government that people will respond to, government institutions that are required and necessary for a civilized society to function, from a court system you can trust to police agencies that you can rely on. But most importantly, it's the ultimate affront to the dignity of all people. Whether it's in Latin America, in the Northern Triangle, or Eastern Europe, or Southeast Asia, or Africa, it affects the ability to make progress on almost any front. Where corruption lives, almost everything else atrophies. Although our government uses both incentives as well as disincentives to impact on and ease corruption in these countries, we don't have the capacity to do it on our own. Those elements in governments that are rife with corruption, even they have good people inside, but are deathly afraid to do anything about it because there are no institutional or power centers that they can rely on to support their effort to speak out and speak up. Without the support of the business community or civil society or academia, they're left powerless to do what they know has to be done. Where a judicial system is corrupt, it's not possible to grow a business. Where intellectual property is stolen, it's not possible to innovate. Where media does not function freely, it's not possible to hold the powerful accountable. Let me give you a few examples. The President has asked me to be the point person on Ukraine and Russia's, I'll use the word accurately, invasion of Ukraine, as well as the Northern Triangle of Guatemala, Honduras, and El Salvador, which is a source of incredible instability in the isthmus. When the Soviet Union fell, Ukraine became independent, a chance for a newfound democratic institutions to flourish, but Russia found other ways to control Ukraine with the use of oligarchs and corruption and energy as foreign policy tools. Though the Soviet Union collapsed and Ukraine got its freedom, nothing happened except corruption took root deeply in Ukrainian society. And then along came the Maidan, the second revolution after the Orange Revolution, where the people of Ukraine took to the streets and to the town center called the Maidan, demanding that their government be accountable. The then leader, quote, popularly elected leader, whom I was on the phone with, urging him not to have snipers, began to shoot. He didn't shoot, but he shot out of the country, leaving behind his own zoo, literally a zoo he had, and incredible wealth and mansions, demonstrating for all the world to see just how thoroughly corrupt the government was. But there was a demand for freedom. We made it clear to the newly elected government and Mr. Poroshenko, I've spent many, many days in Ukraine and with before and after. Mr. Poroshenko came along and he began to build a debt. He was an oligarch himself. But I judge people by their motives when they, quote, give it the office. He lost billions of dollars in investments he had in Russia in his chocolate empire in order to try to begin to set up a democracy. He's outperformed European expectations and most people's expectations to try to build a democracy. But the constant refrain the president authorized me to speak to was, you must demonstrably move on corruption in your country. They've been working hard to reform their system. It's beginning to pay off. New laws on asset disclosure, independent National Anti-Corruption Bureau, greater government transparency, and so much more. I speak with President Poroshenko and the Speaker, Mr. Yatsenyuk, almost weekly to continue to bang away at why they have to take on risk themselves, the endemic corruption, some of which still exist. And I use you as an example. Some of the leading corporate executives in America, some of the great multinational companies, I'm told, spoke here today, from Coca-Cola to others, I'm sure, that were here. Because they desperately want you investing in Ukraine. They know their entire future lies in the EU and in the West. And the point you have to keep making to them as they approach you is, we will not play if you continue to be paid. We will not engage if you do not act. I was with Mr. Poroshenko on Monday this week at the United Nations. We talked about the great progress that he actually Tuesday, resisting the Russian invasion and attempts to collapse his government. We talked about the need to maintain support in the European Union. I'm going to say something that will be characterized as classically Biden. I'm going to tell you the straight truth, unvarnished. Europe is not enamored with continuing to impose sanctions on Russia because it's costing them some at home. The only reason they are is the president has been emphatic, emphatic that Russia must pay for this invasion or we will pay later. The president loves always quoting, he calls them Bidenisms. You know, it's either pay me now or pay me later, and reality has a way of intruding. If we do not sustain, as long as Ukraine continues to deal as it has, if we do not sustain them, the price will be much larger. Watch what happens in the rest of Eastern Europe. Watch what happens in NATO. And so, we've talked about how cohesion in the EU will crack if Ukraine reverts to its decades-long history of corruption. I know tomorrow you're going to hear from a really — she's not only bright, but a really, really courageous young woman, Paula Dobrzynski. I know her. I met her on the Maidan. She risked her life. She was part of civil society. The hardest transition to make in any of these developing countries who are seeking to come out from under the control of either oligarchs, dictators, and or without come out from under control of spheres of influence, is for civil society to begin, after all the years in opposition, to be willing to get engaged and actually run for political office, to actually dirty their hands and get into the game of trying to change the legislative process. This young woman you're about to hear from tomorrow did just that. She's become a clarion voice. She's been threatened physically, politically, but she speaks out. And I can't tell you, Mark, how happy I am you are showcasing her, because there are young women and men like her in all the countries that are struggling to find a way now. But Kyiv needs a vocal private sector, a vocal business community, a vocal civil society, demanding transparency, all the other things you're doing to try to change the life and circumstance of so many people around the world are going to have little effect. To all you business leaders, as I said, Ukraine and other parts of the world desperately want American investment, business know-how, research and development. Every time I go, and I've now traveled over a million, I guess, a couple hundred thousand miles of since I've been vice president. I've met with almost every major head of state. And every developing country or country trying to emerge, you know what they ask? Can you bring Silicon Valley with you? Well, you think I'm kidding? I'm not kidding. You all know it. You're all extremely well-traveled and sophisticated. But it won't make much difference if we can't deal with the corrupt systems. Make it absolutely clear you're ready, but you will not engage unless officials are not engaged in taking kickbacks, unless there's transparency in their law, unless contracts are protected, unless there's a judicial system that you can count on. That's the only way it will change. It will not be by the exhortations of Vice President Joe Biden or President Barack Obama. Another example close to home is the Northern Triangle. There's no reason why Central America can't be the bridge to between North and South America. For the first time in anyone's life, you can look at the hemisphere from Canada to the tip of Argentina and envision a continent that is democratic, middle class, and free. It's within our reach. It can be transformative. But what we have is we have, at a minimum, beyond Venezuela and a few other places, we have this incredible bottleneck in Central America. Imagine what you can do in the business community if you're able to build the electric grid needed to bring energy to 70% of the populations that have no energy. Imagine the entrepreneurial fire you could light if we actually build a gas pipeline from Texas through Mexico down across the isthmus. Imagine what is possible. Imagine how instead of 70% of the youth in each of those countries saying their desire is to leave for America and not stay home, imagine what we can do if we can begin to build a civil society for them as well as our own naked self-interest. But Central America is still mired in corruption. That's why when the president asked me to manage the policy in the hemisphere, I spent time in each of those countries, meeting with each of those leaders, putting together what they asked me to do, because I had drafted Plan Colombia back in 2000, well, before that, it finally passed, which transformed Colombia, which was on the brink of becoming nothing more than a narco state. That's not about me. It's about the Colombians. And they said, will you draft such a law for us? And the president authorized me to do that with the help of the Congress. But the sine qua non for proceeding was dealing with corruption. At the end of the Civil War in Guatemala, the United Nations put in place the Guatemalan Anti-Corruption Commission. They call it CSIG after the Civil War. And it did great work cleaning out corruption. But the leadership, as I put together this plan with them signing on because they desperately need help, didn't want to renew its mandate. But with the president's permission, I insisted we would not help unless they renewed the mandate. And what's the result? The president is thrown out of office, will probably be thrown in jail. The vice president's behind bars. The bulk of the leadership was thoroughly corrupt and is in jail, going to jail, or in exile. They've elected somebody who's going to have a tough time. He looks like he's squeaky clean, a comedian with no past electoral experience, except that he looks like he is thoroughly committed to continuing to clean up the system. The Guatemalan people have turned out in the hundreds of thousands because they think for the first time they have a chance. They have a chance. They remain committed to purging from government and governmental institutions, corruption. We have to help. But the same needs to be done in the rest of Central America to open up the enormous possibilities, establish, as I said, an electric grid that will bring light to enormous segments of the community, not unlike what we did in the TVA back in the 30s. And I don't have to tell those of you who are in business the possibilities of pipelines, shipping, business opportunities, expansion of ports and airports, and the opportunities are available to you. But I'm here to ask you for your help in a public-private partnership, to insist on standards that will give these countries a chance to deliver for their people. And it can only be done with more transparency, openness, and giving people the opportunity to participate. The second issue that sort of overrides all that you've talking about and will talk about is the issue of sustainable development and extreme poverty. I'd like to very briefly focus on one issue, what the President's initiative in Africa called Power Africa. We're providing not only resources and expertise, but incentives to the continent of Africa to invest in clean energy technology to bring power to people across the continent and also generate jobs. A few weeks ago, I met in my office with President Yayi of Benin, a small West African country about the size of Ohio. Together, we signed a compact to help modernize their power sector, which can again transform that country. With our help, banks will lend money, companies will lay wires, entrepreneurs will open business, and people will rise out of poverty because they can turn on the lights, figuratively and literally. The initial $7 billion commitment from the U.S. government has mobilized more than $20 billion off the sidelines from the private sector and will bring electricity to more than 60 million African homes. Neither the President nor I think government is the answer. We are not. Government is not the answer. The free enterprise system is the answer. But what we found is, if we engage and set goals in the Recovery Act, we spend over $800 billion. I might add, as every outside group has shown, with less than 0.25% waste or fraud. Darrell Issa, the Republican from California, who strongly opposed the act, has hailed it as the model for how we should spend money when we spend it. The reason I mention this to you is that we have an opportunity, a transformative opportunity, to bring power and empower people to do things they never could do before. Grow businesses, teach classes at night, connect with distant families. Many don't understand that giving people hope is sometimes more consequential than giving them help. Everyone in this room understands it. And in this case, we're doing both. But we have to do more of it around the world. People are better than we give them credit for if given a chance. The last issue that needs to be faced is the issue of a generation. It will be the issue for several generations, the dispositive issue. And it overrides every other problem we face. We can literally, not figuratively, be overwhelmed in all of our efforts if we don't deal with it. That's climate change. Not only is it an issue of life and death long term, it's a national security issue. Most people talk about climate change in terms of the science of it. Now, a lot of our friends on the other team, they don't think there's global warming. They also deny gravity. and a few other things. It's just kind of fascinating. But the one thing that gets the attention of my conservative friends, and by the way, let's be honest, they're winners and losers as we deal with climate change. And we have to be careful to take care of the losers. For example, fossil fuel, coal in particular, is a particular culprit as we switch to natural gas, which is cleaner, and to renewable energy, which is even cleaner. But we cannot leave behind an entire way of life, not just a way of living, but a way of life. I come from the coal regions of Scranton, Pennsylvania. As a kid, we moved because coal died, although my family never worked in the mines. We have an obligation to help those folks in West Virginia, Southern Ohio, Wyoming transition, because they're good, decent people doing hard work for a long, long time. But what gets the attention of my conservative friends when I talk about climate change, and it surprises them, is the Department of Defense several years ago put together a very thick compendium on global warming, saying that global warming is a threat multiplier. They talk in no-nonsense terms about our security and our stability. They point out that as time goes on and the physical changes continue to occur, conflicts will occur. Millions of people are displaced, destabilizing existing governments. Those of you who are interested and know a little bit about the war in Darfur, and I've been to Darfur like many of you, that's a consequence of extreme drought, eliminating arable land, and two peoples, African both, but Christian and Muslim, fighting over the arable land. Tens of thousands of people slaughtered and massacred. Look at what's happening in terms of the displacement that's taking place as a consequence of Syria and Iraq and Afghanistan. 1.5 million people fleeing to Europe, coming close to destabilizing some of those governments. Imagine what happens, as the military points out, if sea levels rise 1.5 feet more and you have millions of people in South Asia, literally unable to live in their homes with mass migration. That's the stuff of which conflict is made. That's the stuff which destabilizes governments. That's the stuff of war. Reality has a way of intruding, and it is intruding already. Everyone seems extremely surprised that President Xi, whom I know well because I spent a lot of time with him when he was vice president, I traveled for 5 days with him in China, and he 4 days with me in the United States at the request of President Hu and President Obama, so we'd get to know one another. Everybody said, look at Xi, all of a sudden, he's focused on climate change. There's two things populations don't like, whether they are communists, fascists, democracies, whatever form of government they have. They abhor corruption because they don't benefit, and they don't like dying because of the environment, without water that's clean, air that you can breathe. The estimates are that in China alone, they say 1,500,000 die per year because of smog. Other estimates, I will not challenge your estimates, say as many as 4 million people a year die. You want to get the attention of a government, have them do nothing about that. Raise your hand if you've been in Beijing in the last 2 years. You didn't do a lot of jogging in the streets, did you? I'm not being facetious. So the point I'm trying to make is these are deadly serious issues, that if we don't attend to them, and that's not the scope of what you're doing now, all the other things you're doing will be swamped. Swamped by corruption, lack of sustainability for lack of energy and opportunity, and climate change. Governments can do a lot, but we cannot do it without your intellectual, political, and moral support. Those of you who are significant business leaders in this audience, you have more influence on some of these issues than government does. When you stand up and say, no, we have to act. I spoke at a Goldman Sachs North American Energy Summit. I can't remember, and I think it was in the spring. And some of you may have been there. Some of the most successful investors in the country. My recollection was there were about 150 people. And I asked those investors, what was the long play? I have the dubious distinction, I'm not proud of it, of being listed as the poorest man in Congress. You think I'm joking? I wish it wasn't true. When I got sworn in as vice president, I did my financial disclosure statement. As my wife can say, you can Google this. Front page of the Washington Post said, quote, it's probable no man has ever assumed the office with fewer assets than Joe Biden. I assume they were talking financial assets since my net worth was between $50,000 and $150,000, not counting the equity in my home. So I'm no expert, but I asked, what's the long play? What's our energy future? And they responded. A number of major corporations are already pricing in the cost of carbon with as much as $50 a ton. It's just a reality. Pay me now or pay me later. It's a cost. A cost. So when you speak in your communities, when you speak to my colleagues in the House and the Senate and state legislative bodies, play long, not short, okay? Talk about the need to actually respond to some of the obvious things where there's very little or no academic debate. People listen to you. Last month, I was in California to announce a $102 million competitive grant to companies, businesses, universities, and research laboratories in 37 states working to reduce the cost of solar energy by 75% by the year 2000. Some of you know now that in terms of a kilowatt hour, wind energy is as cheap as coal right now. Because of some of you in this audience, we have radically, radically reduced the cost of solar energy. Radically. We're on the cusp of making renewable energy competitive. Competitive across the board with carbon-based fuels. On that same trip, I participated in the U.S.-China summit, leaders' summit on global warming in Los Angeles, which brought together not only leaders from China's federal government, as ours, but also from their state legislators, in effect, their governors. And the governors from four provinces in China that attended, the carbon they emit in those four provinces exceeds the carbon emissions from Japan and Australia combined. Japan, all of Japan, and or all of Australia in four provinces. So what's happening is those local leaders are moving to raise the bar even higher than President Xi has agreed to with President Obama in cutting back emissions. Los Angeles and Beijing, two of the world's great cities, are working together on low-carbon urban planning, research projects, and technology exchanges. That's what we need to combat, at least in part, climate change. Partnerships at every level, city leaders working with their federal governments, governments working with the private sector, nonprofits, the academic community. That's how we'll find solutions. But I'm preaching to the choir here because this is all about public-private partnerships. Ultimately, partnerships do more than just take us on take on real challenges we're seeing day to day, challenges that affect people's daily lives. Partnerships are vital to helping generate a virtuous cycle. They create sustainable energy solutions and will position us to compete economically in the 21st century and create millions of new jobs. More jobs are created in the solar energy area than any other part of industry. Right here in the United States. And these are good paying jobs. These are middle-class jobs you can raise a family on. I know I'm referred to all the time in Washington as middle-class Joe. In Washington, that meant as a compliment. That means you're probably not sophisticated if you're middle-class. But I'm sophisticated about the middle-class. Without us figuring how to deal them back into the game, ladies and gentlemen, you're all in trouble. When the middle class does well, business does very well, and the poor have a way up. And if the middle class continues to shrink, they are the glue that has held the political and social fabric of this nation together for the past 100 years. Because what's America about? I can describe America to you in one word: possibilities. Possibilities. And when people think their possibilities are no longer within their reach, things change. Things change. I have a lot of economists with me who are great academics and receive significant awards. And when I say middle class, the debate will begin. Is it 51,500 or 52? Middle class is not a number. And I'll end with this. Middle class is a value set. Middle class in America means you're able to own your own home and not just have to rent it. That you can send your kid to a park where you know they're going to come home safely. That you can send them to high school that you know if they do well, they are able to get to college, and if they get to college, you can pay to get them there. And when your mom dies, you can take your dad in when he's geriatric and care for him and hope your children never have to care for you. That's why we've been the most powerful nation on earth. That's the reason. And if you take a look at everyone from the IMF to Standard & Poor's, the greatest concern they have about economic growth is the concentration of wealth. I'm not Bernie Sanders. He's a great guy, by the way. No, he really is. I'm not a populist, but I'm a realist. If you make widgets, there's not enough people to buy your widgets, you're not going to do well. So, folks, we got a lot to do. We got a lot to do, but we have enormous possibilities with you all in the game. George used to always kid me in the Senate because I was quoting Irish poets. Everybody thought I quoted Irish poets because I'm Irish. That's not why I quote Irish poets. I quote them because they're simply the best poets in the world. No offense to my Greek friends, Thalidides, no, but they're the best poets. And one of my favorite contemporary poets is Seamus Heaney. And he wrote a poem called The Cure at Troy. And there's a line of stanza in that poem that better describes where we are right now, in my view, if we seize the opportunity. And I'll get out of your hair. The poem has a stanza that says, "History teaches us not to hope on this side of the grave. But then, once in a lifetime, that tidal wave of justice rises up, and hope and history rhyme." I've been doing this for a long time, since I was a 29-year-old kid. I have never been more optimistic about the possibilities of this great nation. We have a chance, and I mean it,
to make hope and history rhyme. We have a chance to bend history just a little bit if we'll just get out of our own way. There's a reason why we're better positioned than any other nation in the world today. We have the greatest research university in the world. No other place in the world has what we have. We're the most agile venture capitalist in the world. We will, for the remainder of the two-thirds of this century, have the cheapest energy of any place in the world, North America. Your children will not talk about outsourcing. They'll be talking about insourcing. We have the most productive workers in the world. Every objective study shows American workers are 3 to 4 times as productive as workers in China, for example. And we have a court system that protects intellectual property and where everyone knows they can have their contractual disputes adjudicated fairly. So we're better positioned. We just need two things to lock it down. We need the best educated workforce in the world, and that's why we need your help in pushing for more investment in education. And 12 years of education is no longer sufficient. 14 is the minimum people need in America today. And secondly, we need a massive infusion of investment in our infrastructure. You will stay where you can get your product to market and raw materials as quickly to the floor as you can, or else you'll go where you can do it more quickly and economically. So we have great opportunities. And it really gets down to public-private partnerships. And you're the people in this room gathered here today that can do it. We need you. We need you badly. The country needs you. So I thank you for the technological capacity that you represent, the intellectual honesty that you possess, and the determination you have to continue to make America the greatest nation in the world. We are that now. There's no reason why we will not be that way 100 years from now if we do what we have to do. Thank you very much.